order to save the village, we had to destroy it. Those of you who are old enough to remember the Vietnam War know that this is not an apocryphal statement. It actually took place. And I tell you this, that same type of rationale is present in the world right now in the form of, in order to save the planet, we have to destroy it. Now, we may laugh at this statement and say, for sure, this is apocryphal. It's never going to happen. But what I'm saying in these videos is do not underestimate that it will, and focus and determination and capacity of various factions to actually carry this out. I say there are actually demolition experts. For example, if you want to pull down a building, you bring in demolition experts and they set charges on the main support columns. And those charges sit there, and at the appropriate time, someone at a distance pushes a button, and boom, 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 boom. Building collapses. Kind of like World Trade Center building number 7. Kind of like that. So they're experts in demolition. What we don't realize is that there are experts in demolition on a cosmic scale. But some of us are starting to be aware of this. So in preparing to bring down a building, the charges are set on the most vulnerable points of that building. In preparing to bring down a world, the charges are set on the most vulnerable points of that world. And by bringing down a world, we're talking about bringing down the civilization that resides on that planet, because it is seen that this civilization is somehow wiping out the ecosystems, wiping out the planet, is going to bring the planet down in a very bad way. So in order to minimize the damage to the planet, some intentional damage is inflicted on the planet to collapse that civilization, so that then the planet can then heal and be restored. That is the rationale behind it. And there are teams who are extremely skilled in this type of work. Now, what I have seen, what has been revealed to me, is that those teams are here now on this planet. The planetary demolition teams are actually here on this planet, and the generalissima of those teams is also here on this planet. November 22nd, 2010, the CEO, the operational commander of this demolition exercise, gained full capacity to function here on this planet. And the demolition teams who have been working, setting up the charges in the vulnerable points of the world, are now getting their final instructions and intentions and preparing to set off the charges, as it were. Now, if you understand cosmic politics, you will not be so caught by surprise by this development. There are councils of worlds. That is a fact. And matters like this are discussed. There are disagreements that take place. Not everything is all smoothly under control. One group may decide, you know, this is what has to be done and we're going to do it. Others will say, no, we think there's a better way. So that's why in this world you have various options that seem to be flickering around. You catch glimpses of them. One of them is, no, we can scale things back. We can downsize. That'll work. And we can heal the planet gradually. That's, and then another faction says, no, it's already past the point of no return. Radical surgery is necessary. So there are not smooth agreements in cosmic politics, just as there are not smooth agreements in terrestrial politics at all. Same thing in the cosmos on a grander scale. It's the same thing. I mean, we have this fantasy that higher up the cosmic corporate ladder, everything is all smooth. It is not at all. Nothing like that. Now, maybe the planet has said, get this civilization off my back. You know, the civilization is killing me like fleas on a dog. And then in response to that, a demolition team comes into the world and is given access to this planet. The planet allows it, so to speak. That's very much a possibility. But bottom line is, this demo team is here. They have been here for quite some time in advanced preparation, like setting up the charges in the building. And the only thing that is yet to occur is that button has not yet been pushed. So everything seems fine. You look at a building and there it is. Oh, it's a wonderful high-rise building, and it looks like it has looked for the last 30 years. And then with the push of a button, suddenly the entire thing disappears in a matter of 5 seconds. You know, that is the situation we literally are in with the civilization. As we go about our day, we tend to believe that we are masters of the universe because of the materiality that we have accomplished. You know, we are able to dress ourselves and move ourselves about and feed ourselves and house ourselves in such a way that we really think we've got it pretty much figured out, because we're able to take raw materials, transport them to manufacturing centers, and then using all sorts of pressure and force, transform those raw materials into consumer products, and then distribute those and get them out to the people. And we're able to do that in such an efficient manner that we've all come to the conclusion that, hey, maybe we've got this all figured out, that we're masters of the universe. You know, nothing can touch us. I tell you, though, that is an incredible blindness that we have, and a tremendous vulnerability that we've got lulled into this false sense of security, that somehow everything is okay, when right underneath our noses, there's this demolition team set to bring this whole civilization down. Because if you look at it objectively, and scientists will tell you, there is an alarming decline in the ecosystems of this planet. And some would say that it's reached the point where it's likely to be irreversible. And at any rate, if you extrapolate the population increase into the future, and you do those calculations, etc., and take everything into account, you might come to the conclusion that the planet is going to die in the future, near future. You could very easily arrive at that conclusion if you're taking from a certain perspective. So we are living in a fool's paradise, somehow believing that we've got it all figured out and everything is stable and it's going to continue on like this. Now, the demolition teams have studied and researched the situation, found out what the vulnerabilities are, infiltrated those areas, and set up the means to bring those vulnerable points down and start a domino effect. I spoke about that in the video, how the world fell to pieces, how they infiltrated certain key central banks, global banks, and by bringing those global banks down, they're going to actually start a domino effect throughout the entire financial structure of the planet. Not so difficult to do, and they're going to do this by digitally manipulating the reserves of the banks so that the reserves seem to disappear. Suddenly disappear. It's done through high-speed computer networks, and that will then cause the banks to crash, and that will cause a panic on Wall Street, and the panic will spread throughout the world, and that's what it'll accomplish. And then once the financial structures have collapsed, then the other pieces begin to fall. Then the resources and the distribution of those resources begin to crack and fall apart over time, and then the wars come, and the conflicts, and the plagues, and the famines, and all the four horsemen of the apocalypse, they start to ride, and ride hard at that time. They have it all figured out. They're experts at doing this. Don't underestimate them. I'm telling you that for sure. Most people have a sense of there's some vulnerability or fragility in the world. That is the sense we're feeling. I said on my video I posted on July 4th saying that towards the end of July, we would start feeling that vulnerability more than ever, to a point where we'd start realizing, uh-oh, something is really not right in the world. And we are very, very on the brink of collapse in some way. We can begin to intuitively feel that very strongly. That is what has happened. We know there is some type of severe vulnerability. We are not masters of the universe, and that is a very tough pill to swallow. Great disillusionment of that. However, in the ultimate sense, we are masters of our own destiny. And that is the crucial point that I'm stressing in these videos. We do not control the play of existence. However, we do control whether or not we play the game of existence. Existence is an idea that we are entertaining. We don't have to entertain that idea. There's no mandate that we entertain that idea. There is no authority telling us we must entertain that idea. We are simply insisting on this ourselves. We're telling ourselves this because we want to see what happens. We are fascinated by this game of existence. But the authority that is telling us we must remain with this is actually ourselves. We're the one telling ourselves this. God, the Prime Creator, is not telling us that we must remain fixated on this idea and entertaining this idea and see how it all plays out. Absolutely not. We don't have to play this game of existence. Therefore, we are masters of our own destiny in this regard, because we can entertain another scenario, another idea, another game, something that we like much better. We have that option. These times bring to mind a parallel to biblical times, when there was a zealot named Barabbas who was really the leader of a revolution against Rome. And he recruited Jesus and saying, "You've got to help us out. With you as the general, we can't lose. We're going to be able to drive Rome out of here and be free of the oppression." And of course Jesus turned him down, which led to his eventual demise. And I know a lot of people may question the passivity of those who are spiritual minded, oriented towards spiritual truth. They seem very passive and they don't want to join Barabbas in the revolution. There's a reason for that. Very important reason, because with clarity you see that the dance of existence is inherently conflictual, and there's nothing you can do about that. The only option you have is to choose a different idea, entertain a different idea than the idea of existence. You cannot find a way. Let me say this again. You cannot find a way to force actual change on the play of existence. That is impossible. So when you realize that, you say, you give up the revolution. Okay? And then you decide, I see what the real option is. Now I see it. And then that's what actual wisdom is. The actual wisdom is to recognize the real option is to choose another idea. I'm sensing that there is a certain degree of wisdom among the viewers here on this channel, YouTube channel, because nobody has pressured me or tried to engage me, say, "Why don't you lead some kind of counter movement, or try to do something about this? Try to, you know, why don't we draft you into some important position?" That hasn't happened, because I believe people viewers are feeling, you know what? We're starting to sense that there's some wisdom that we have. That option of choosing a new idea instead of trying to force some sort of outcome on existence. We know historically that never works. There's a reason for that. There's a profound reason for that. That's because every idea has a dynamics to it that are inherent with that idea. And there's no way that you can cause those effects to be separated from that idea. Just like the spirit cannot be separated from the prime creator, even though spirit may imagine is possible, so too effects cannot be separated from the idea, even though we can imagine it's possible. It's never actual. So as this is dawning, we've done a lot of work, and this realization is at the moment, it's starting to dawn. And I think a lot more people are realizing that the so-called passive option ends up being the wise option. It's not just a matter of non-resistance. No, it's not like we're trying to all be like Gandhi, you know. No one's being asked to be like that at all. You know, peaceful non-resistance to bring social change, because that's still aiming at some change in existence. But what we're seeing is that you cannot force actual change. You cannot actually change the dynamic of existence and the way that it plays. That's impossible. So any stability you arrive at in existence is temporary. That is a fact. And it will be swept away by the tides of existence, for sure. Everything we build is like sandcastles on the shore. And high tides always will come and sweep them away. So the real goal as we sit here right now is to return to the real option that we have, which is to choose another idea, entertain a different scenario, different idea, different game. And we do have the power and capacity to actually do that. That's a fact. And perhaps it might help if we realize that what is going to happen here on this planet is not unique. It has happened over and over and over again. It's very much standard fare. It's meat and potatoes of existence. We keep being tricked into thinking that somehow our situation is special and unique. It is not. Never is in existence. It's the same old song being played over and over and over again, and we're just changing our costumes a little bit to fool ourselves into thinking that this time it's special and unique. Never is. So we don't need to really overreact to what's taking place. It's more like a ho-hum, here we go again. And just the key is to remind ourselves, what are our options really? Remain focused on your true options. That is the key. What is the big picture? What are the true options? Now, let us turn to one more issue, and that is, I'm sure that almost everyone has caught glimpses and heard faint songs about the idea of somehow escaping the situation that's to come, sidestepping it, ascending, shifting somehow out of it. There are ways, options to safety. There's a lot of that has been percolating over the last several decades in this world. And there seems to be a lot of different sources giving different types of information on this. And for those who may ask, is there a way, is any of this true? I say most emphatically, yes, there will be a way, or maybe several ways, to sidestep the situation. Absolutely, yes. Now, those who are doing the demolition on this planet may not want anybody to escape, and they may not like it at all. In fact, I know for a fact they will be very, very angry that many people will sidestep their troublemaking and mischief here. And yet we will do it anyway. Demolition teams and those who support them. There's a great support network, a great ideology believing that this is the right and just, righteous thing to do. Those that ideology will not give any permission for anybody to sidestep this, but you know what? We don't need their permission. They will try to bully and intimidate people here into refusing to exercise their options. But I tell you for sure, they're not bullying me. They don't have to bully you. They're not intimidating me. They don't have to intimidate you. That's what these videos are all about. Overcome that intimidation factor. It can be done. It will be done. And in future videos, we will go into this in even greater depth. Stay tuned for this very important and helpful source of support and information. Okay, much clarity to you always. That's it.